From the mobile unit mothership of Abduction Studios, hovering somewhere off the map of consensus reality, good evening, and welcome to the Sun City Girls Radio Network. I'm your host, Mexican film legend, Cantinflas. On tonight's show, we'll be featuring a variety of high-quality entertainment processed through our unique transmitters and specially prepared for the on-the-wire BBC program. And so without further comment, sit back, relax, and allow yourself to experience this next hour of excellent programming. Enjoy.
Has learned that in the last 48 hours, intelligence sources have detected an increase in the number of threats against major U.S. cities, including New York, Los Angeles, and Washington, D.C. Nothing is specific with regard to either targets or times, but senior law enforcement officials are conferring to determine the seriousness of the threats, to determine a response, and whether to raise the color-coded terrorist threat level. For now, that seems unlikely. Jim Hickey, ABC News.
Thank you. Nagasaki. The Saki that destroyed the Japanese.
Mm-hmm. I am trying like hell.
He's in the drink.
Good.
You can tell her you love her with words.
If he'll stay away for good.
I'm just sitting over here writing. You want to commit suicide or something so I can be the first to tell the world?
To burn my life.
Coffee, AM, PM.
Thank you.
once was a Dogon from Mali who cast a spell on a sleepy anthropologist named Wally. He chanted, "Science is tragic, and this is black magic." So he awoke as a dog on the island of Bali. Good show. Sacrifice in the USA. Sacrifice, sacrifice, sacrifice in the USA.
Welcome to another edition of Sacrifice in the USA. Tonight we're going to talk about human sacrifice. Oh yes, you know that phenomenon of the missing child in America? The horror of every parent. Just the thought of a little Billy or Susie running to the store for a half gallon of milk and not coming home forever. Yeah. Never talk to strangers or get into a stranger's car, Ma and Pa say to their offspring, and that's true. Some are kidnapped and escaped, some are kidnapped and raped, and even killed, their bodies left to rot in the forest or desert, yet many are just never found, never heard from again. It's so easy to blame a, you know, satanic cult or a Manson-esque freak group or a crazed pervert. You know, of course, these are the ones that are stereotype villains, you know, who do such god-awful things to young children. But what of other members of Western society, you know, whether individuals or groups? What about corporate executives or military officers, doctors, lawyers, politicians, small business owners? Are they immune from such acts of kidnapping and all the possibilities that surround the fate of a stolen child? No, they're not. And if you don't believe me, just listen and I'll welcome you to the 20th century, a century in which human nature has not really changed all that much. You've really paid much attention at all in the terms of not necessarily the betterment of mankind, but just in any real change in mankind. The characteristics are the same. The situations, the things are very similar the way they always have been on the face of planet Earth. In the new age, things are not so new, are they? Well, how old are you? I don't know, and I don't care. Now, this is a century, you know, that is fundamentally the same as all previous to it in terms of emotion, customs, tradition, and beliefs. If you can't agree with this, then don't listen to me any further, because I'll only murder your tender little ignorant heart with a stab of my breath. Yeah, human sacrifice to many human beings living right now is an acceptable practice to appease a god or goddess, probably the most potent appeasement available. You know, a sacrifice historically is performed for many reasons, to yield a good crop in the coming years, to obtain wealth or power, to offer thanks to the gods, to appease demons who are feared, among other common and more esoteric motives. Sure, offerings of food, incense, or even the killing of small, lesser animals are quite common and accepted even by Western society, but the idea of killing a human being to satisfy a deity or a host of deities is but a barbaric act of the past or a current atrocity committed only by weirdo fringe cults or groups who pop up now and again in sensationalized news headlines. What I'm saying is that I don't consider it ridiculous to assume that prominent members of American society, even household names, are presently and have been involved in sacrificing human beings. I'm quite convinced that it goes on regularly and has been since the founding of this great nation. I can't point fingers, and I'm not going to. I'm not going to point fingers at anyone because I'm not on the trail of such occurrences. That's not my business. However, secret societies have existed in high power positions since the beginning of time, and perhaps some of the most successful black magicians in terms of achieving wealth, power, and fame, not to mention what they're in for karma-wise in the future, but are residing, as I speak, living right now in the good old U.S. of A. Why not? Can't happen. We're in a civilized nation. That's right, baby. Human sacrifice and black magic are one big giant fact of civilized nations. Or have you been spending all your time drinking out of the tap instead of tapping into the well, or at least tap dancing your way across the graves of those who have spent their lives trying to keep you ignorant? What is war anyway but human sacrifice? For a greater cause. Nobody understands it, so they condone it. In the name of freedom. The great god freedom. That's a deity to be appeased, is it not?
Now, I wouldn't be surprised if insurance salesmen got together with their lobbyist pals and a few senators in some secret organization called Get Rich Quick and burned some kid alive, you know, some male child in a pseudo-Masonic or extra-paganistic ritualistic manner, all in the name of high profits for the next fiscal year. Filmmakers, entertainers, artists, who knows? Just keep saying no to any idea you never heard before and let little Billy walk the street at night up to the corner market for a loaf of bread. You know, it's all big business anyway. Supply and demand, buy and sell, you gotta take chances to get to the top. But once you get up there, it's time to fend off the upstarts. Maybe all this is just my own exercise and, you know, imagination. But maybe little Billy will be eaten by the next man you vote for at the polls. He might even use chopsticks.
I can look in your eyes. Not nearly the price.
No, I don't need a chimney to get in.
Baked gingerbread cookies.
My wife got tired of me running around, so she tried to keep me home. Well, she broke my knuckles and hit my clothes, but I continued to roam. Well, she finally hit my weak spot, threatened to throw my bottle out. Well, or from the basement to the rooftop, everybody could hear me shout, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Oh, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Hey, you give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Cause I can't get well without Muscatel. Gotta have Hot Lucy when I go out walking, y'all. Well, one real dark and dreary night, as I was staggering home to bed, well, the bandit jumped from the shadows and put a blackjack side on my head. That cat took my watch, my ring, my money, but I didn't make a sound. But when he reached and grabbed my bottle, you could hear me for blocks around. Give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Hey, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Oh, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Beat my head out of shape, but leave my grape. Watch ring money don't mean nothing, just don't mess with my wine, Jim. Well, one day while crossing the avenue, a big car knocked me down. Well, I was stretched out tying up traffic, and crowds came for blocks around. Well, the police searched through my pockets, and as I was headed to the funeral parlor, well, when one of those cops grabbed my bottle jack, I jumped right up and began to holler, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Oh, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Don't touch my wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Cause I can't cut loose without my juice. Well, one day my house got fire as I was laying down sleeping off a nap. And when I woke up, everything was burning with a pop and a crackle and a snap. Well, the fireman tapped up my TV set and tore my apartment apart. But when he reached and got my bottle, I screamed with all my heart, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Hey, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Whoa, don't touch my wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
So I could drink one toast before I roast. I don't want to go out half-baked. We might as well get all tore up, y'all. Well, you can take all those Hollywood movie stars, Cornelius Bullion, Robert Abernathy, Larry Storch, Sterling Holloway, Bruce Cabot, Fatty Arbuckle, Dwight Fry, Cameron Mitchell, Edwin Milkburgle, Jose Ferrer, Dirk Bugles, Charlton Heston, Rin Tin Tin, Leslie Howard, Forrest Tucker, Rip Torn, Joseph Cotton, and E.G. Marsham. Line them all upside the wall. Take a gigantic jug beside them and tell me to take my choice. Well, there be no doubt which one I chose. The minute I raise my voice, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Whoa, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Oh, give me that wine.
Don't touch that bottle.
Well, those cocks look fine, but I love my wine. Now, some folks like money, some like to dance and dine. But I'll be happy with David Susskind.
Well, that's it. We have forgiven the frequencies. Massage his scalp. Yes. I used to massage his scalp and then give him a cleansing now. Okay, go. Is he speaking yet? Give him some more now. He'll be talking soon. I would recommend one more just for the little bugger. Give him a little more activity. Excellent. Now, turn him over on his back. Let's start it up again. Ready? Execute. Satisfactory. All right, that's enough for now. All right, okay, one more. Very good. You can quit now.
Yes, master.
Infrared energy before it can reach the surface.
Anywhere, all on sale.
Narcoleptic.
Necrophiliac.
He's not narcoleptic.
It's orbiting other stars.
Soldiers who were wounded in Iraq and have...
Are you worried, John?
No.
McDonald Observatory.
Walter Reed Army Medical Center.
The families are speaking to somebody that doesn't care.
Military says guerrillas ambushed a military patrol.
And pretend that he's a circus clown.
If you could get some remorse, that may help a little bit, but there won't be any.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another edition of the greatest thing going on the radio today. It's my favorite show. It's Lester's Dictionary. Lester will be in the studio tonight to get you to open up your notebooks and, you know, so they're not in order alphabetically, get you to write in these words and give you a new definition on life and jazz. You know, the hip thing, and he wants you to know what words really mean. Dig? No, he hasn't defined dig for us yet, but I can hardly wait till he does. Are you grooving with me? Lester's coming right in. He's gonna show you how it is. He's gonna tell it like it was. And he's gonna give you a definition of anything you need to know. Oh, he's got some great ones this week. I went through his proof sheets. So get your pen and paper out and take these babies down. Here he comes. He's waiting for you. Oh, here's Lester!
Thank you very much, Walt Bemo. Tonight, we're going to start off with a word called objectivity. And here's the definition. The way it is, objectivity is the way it is, regardless of what any other source says, can only be expressed by an individual about him or herself because all others are outside looking in. Can also be an all-out lie. However, even lies are objective. Yeah, it's my show. Next word, subjectivity. So turn the pages over to S, you know, fill in the blanks. Subjectivity, an irrelevant term which was manufactured to form self-conscious thought patterns and limits in one's ability to express oneself. A distraction, a trick. The next word is way back in the back of your charts there. UFO. Unidentified flying objects. That is, anything and everything in the sky. Now we go to the word bus. B-U-S. An unidentified land object. Now we're going to ULO. I should have put that after UFO. It does start with the same letter. ULO. Unidentified land object, i.e. U. Or the abominable snowman, or etc. Next is ELO. Now we a thing. No. Electric light orgasm, otherwise known as photosynthesis, for all you botany majors out there. Then we go to UWO. That's an unidentified water object, like the Loch Ness Monster and submarines. Get it? Then we go to USO. Unidentified space object. Anything taking up space, because nothing can be identified, only interpreted. Which brings us to our next word, interpretation. I kind of like the way I tie these together. Yeah, it's for you, not for me. I got better things to do. I could be sipping some gin right now. Interpretation is one perception out of an infinity of perceptions of whatever one chooses or happens upon to perceive. Isn't that contrived? Yes. Which brings us to my longest expose of the evening, sensationalism. Now, sensationalism is defined as the essence of Western civilization, semicolon, always never living up to its name, semicolon, the power behind the spectacle, semicolon, the very foundation of media, semicolon. If an event or person or entity can be portrayed as sensational, in parentheses, comma, then attention of the masses can be drawn towards it like a magnet, and in parentheses, curiosity, to focus on the outer shell of its substance or hype without ever questioning its greater meaning, semicolon, a more powerful weapon than nationalism, i.e., sensational nationalism. Like a short attention span, semicolon, if the media were to ever focus entirely on non-sensational events, people, ideas, etc., it would totally undermine the concept of the media itself as we have come to know it and come to expect it, and its foundation would crumble and collapse, which in turn would create a new sensation, sick, as opposed to a manufactured one. Sorry, I got off on that tangential excursion. The next word is Vatican. That's V-A-T-I-C-A-N. It's a large pail or vat of distilled papal pus surrounded by fences and armed guards in southern Italy. Next word is portable Vatican, which is the same as Vatican, only mobile, encased in a plastic bubble. Okay, we're going to run through some real quick ones here. It's a quickie section of our segment tonight. Here we go. Demon seed. The male sperm. Semen. 13-day-old. Trail mix. Fertilizer. Nixon. N-I-X-O-N. The single longest strand of one's anal hair. Scunion. An entire patch of anal hair. Sklurch. One with long, oily head hair. Swag. To catch your upper lip on a protruding nail and be stuck until the fire department can be contacted to free you. Or a sex-crazed preacher. Strife, a word supposedly meaning crisis, but which actually was inserted into the English language for poets due to the shortage of words that can be rhymed with life. A woof, a person obsessed with pop jazz music, i.e. Al Jarreau, Spyro Gyra, etc. Geek, one who bites heads off chickens. Super geek, one who bites heads off geeks or retired bullfighters. Roid togs, that's R-O-I-D. T-O-G. Roid Talk. An insurance company executive with a severe case of hemorrhoids. Squelcher. One who coughs up phlegm, but instead of spitting, swallows it again. A gimp doggle. G-I-M-P. Gimp. Doggle. D-O-G-G-L-E. A mormonic missionary with a dirty white shirt. I like that one. Dexan. D-E-X-A-N. A dead Texan. Arson, Christian incense. Hog whip, pork custard. I'm getting hungry. A blue boy, blue boy. A sexually active old man with purplish testicles. Captain Hook, men or a man with curved penises or a curved penis. I like to get the past tense in there or the pluralistic device happening. Well, that's all for this week's edition of Lester's Dictionary. I hope you all enjoyed it. And next week I think we're going to start off with a word that starts with X. So get your pages ready to start with X next week. And until then, I had you going there, didn't I? We'll be right back.
future cousin of the hamburger.
You probably think it was just one of those theoretical connective models that we all sooner or later have to fall back on when that house of cards just falls. And in part, you're right. Yet, this time, everything didn't work.
Dark and weep for their sins, for they do not make me sick discussing their duty to God. Not one of them kneels to another or to his own kind that lived thousands of years ago. Not one of them is respectable or unhappy all over the earth.
Gently, Johnny, my gigolo. Gently, Johnny, gently, Johnny. Gently, Johnny, my gigolo. Thank you.
Thank you.
Elvis?
Yes, Colonel Parker.
Stay away from that wheelbarrow. You don't know nothing about machinery.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Watches you, Kuso. They don't know what you want. The prophet holds my thigh. So this product you will buy, right?
Thank you.
Well, that's it for our show tonight. Join us again next time as we beam from the mounted caskets off of extinct satellites in a galaxy near you. Hopefully, we have provided an amusing and perhaps an enlightening break from the countless hours of utterly meaningless drivel being force-fed to you on a daily basis by your world cultural, entertainment, and news media outlets. We understand that most of humanity is clueless in almost all levels of achieving enlightenment. However, we do know that a few of you out there have not yet been roped in, so to speak, by the malevolent dark forces masquerading as your governmental, religious, and social institutions. So that being said, have a fine evening, and until we meet again, I am your host, Kantine Floss. Good night.